This program is made possible by the partners and friends of Bob Yandian Ministries. Coming up on this episode of Student of the Word.
We go through times of opposition. We know there's times when governments stand against us. We know there's times when religious attacks come against us. We know there's times when the world, through the press, comes against us and starts to attack us. Because all of these are part of the world system. We stand alone as far as the church is concerned, and this is how God displays himself in the earth, is through the church. It's up to us to stand for the things of God, stand on the word of God, and realize one thing also. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell. All the demons, all the birds of the air cannot destroy it.
For more than 40 years, Bob Yandian has been an expositor of the Bible, making seemingly complicated doctrine easy to understand. Grab your Bible and something to take notes with and study the Word of God with Pastor Bob Yandian.
Good morning. Welcome again to Student of the Word with Pastor Bob Yandian. Glad to have you today. We are in the midst of the series on the kingdom parables out of Matthew chapter 13, an introduction by Jesus to the upcoming church, the upcoming church age, but also a description of the tribulation. Two time periods, very interesting. Why did he pick those two? It's because these are the two time periods he'll be absent from the earth. Because at the beginning, Jesus Christ comes to the earth. That's the first coming of Jesus. At the end of the tribulation, we will have the second coming of Jesus. The first coming of Jesus was temporary. It lasted for 33 years. But the second coming of Jesus will be forever. He'll be here for 1,000 years during the millennial reign of Jesus Christ. And then after that, he'll be here also as we have a new heaven and a new earth. But again, the two time periods where Jesus is gone is right now during the church age. And when the church age ends, the church will rise to meet Jesus at the end. He'll come back, as it says in the book of 2 Timothy, we look forward to his appearing and his kingdom. His appearing is for the rapture of the church. His kingdom is for his coming back to stay here forever. And so again, as we come to the time when the church will be taken out, the earth will be filled with believers and unbelievers. The believers will be taken to heaven and the earth will be left with unbelievers only for just a matter of minutes. But as soon as the church is removed, Antichrist can reveal himself. Until that time, he cannot reveal himself because he who hinders, that's the church, is here. And we're hindering Antichrist from being exposed, being shown to the world. But as soon as we're gone, Antichrist will be shown. And then right at that exact moment also, 144,000 Jews receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. Again, we shift from the church time, the time of the Gentiles, back to the time of the Jews for 7 more years. Really, the time of the Jews, to be honest with you, the time of the Jews has never ended. It just stopped. And when Jesus died on the cross, there were still 7 years of Jewish history left to be fulfilled, and that clock stopped. And between that time period and that last 7 years has come the church age. We've been here now for over 2,000 years, but again, there are still 7 years left of Jewish time to be fulfilled. And that's why the church cannot be here. The whole earth shifts back to Jewish time for 7 more years. We'll have a temple, we'll have sacrifices. Just like after Jesus left, they will make no difference. But again, that will be the Jewish way of coming to the Lord, the Jews, their way under the Old Testament. And so that will happen. But the moment that Jesus Christ, again, comes and takes us out of the earth, 144,000 Jews receive Jesus as Lord and Savior. And out of Romans 11:25, we find out until the time the Gentiles are removed, there's a partial blindness over Israel. And that blindness will be removed. 144,000 receive Jesus, 12,000 out of each of the 12 tribes. Then their converts begin to spread the gospel. Not only do the 144,000 spread the gospel, but evangelism shifts back again to the nation of Israel and to the city of Jerusalem. In the meantime, it's now been given to the church. The church has received the Great Commission. The Great Commission existed in the Old Testament. Israel was the Jewish custodians of the Word of God and of also the gospel message. They took it to the world. By the time Jesus had come, they had perverted it and were taking religion to the world. They were taking the Jewish religion to the world, of which Jesus said, you compass land and sea. That's what they're supposed to do. Compass land and sea. That's the Great Commission. But their message was wrong. He said, you compass land and sea to make one proselyte, not a convert, not a believer, but a proselyte, a Gentile living like a Jew. under the Jewish law, circumcision, what he eats and all that, which he was never given to the Gentile nations, only to Israel. And it was their schoolmaster to instruct them in Christ or how to spread the good news. So again, how lovely on the mountains are the feet of them, the Old Testament that says they bring glad tidings of peace. And Jesus said, you compass land and sea, and now you make them proselytes instead of converts, proselytes instead of believers. He said, and when you do, you make them twofold more the child of hell than you are yourself. And so he would condemn them greatly. So the two time periods where Jesus is gone is the church age and the tribulation. And that's what these kingdom parables deal with, those two time periods. And they go back and forth, back and forth. We ended last time talking about the wheat and the tares. This is the way that Satan will imitate the gospel during the time of the tribulation. And wheat and tares look alike, except one has fruit, one does not. One will sustain you, one will not. One has the nutrition you need. The other one is just appearance. And what Satan puts in tares, tares look a lot like wheat, but only Jesus will come back and be able to separate the two, and he'll have the accompanying help of angels. And in Matthew 13, we'll finish with what he started with yesterday. And it says in verse 40 through 43, so as the tares are gathered and burned in the fire, so will also be the end of this age. Notice this age where Jesus was standing was still the Jewish age. That will be resumed at the time of the tribulation. So he says at the end of this age, the Son of Man will send forth his angels. They will gather out of his kingdom all things that offend, those who work iniquity, and shall cast them into the furnace of fire. There shall be wailing and gnashing of teeth. Then shall the righteous shine forth as the sun in the kingdom of the Father. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. And this verse is saying at the end of the tribulation, where Jesus comes back to rule the earth will have believers and unbelievers on it. Just like at the time at the end of the church age, there were believers and unbelievers on the earth. Jesus will appear for the church at the rapture, and believers will be removed from the earth and unbelievers will be left. The opposite will happen at the time when Jesus comes back. When Jesus comes back to rule and reign at the end of the 7 years of tribulation, the earth will be filled with believers and unbelievers, but unbelievers will be removed. And believers will be left to enter into the millennial reign of Jesus Christ, and they will have they'll have normal bodies like we do. And so they'll go into that time period. Death will be removed. They'll live to ripe old ages of a thousand. But we'll have resurrection bodies. We won't have an age limit on us. And the earth will be filled with those in resurrection bodies and those in natural bodies. That's what's coming. In fact, John the Baptist said this also in Matthew chapter 3, verses 11 and 12. I indeed baptize you with water unto repentance, but he who comes after me is mightier than I, whose shoes I am not worthy to latch. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and with fire, and whose fan is in his hand, that's his winnowing fork. His winnowing fork is in his hand. He will thoroughly purge his floor, that's the earth, and gather his wheat, that's believers, into the garner, that's the kingdom, but will burn up the chaff, that's the unbelievers, the weeds. He'll do that with unquenchable fire. And so that verse is telling us again there that at the end of the tribulation where Jesus comes back, there he's going to remove unbelievers from the earth, and they'll be cast into hell for 1,000 years and then be brought up before the great white throne judgment. But in the meantime, on the earth, there'll be people here, and believers from the tribulation will get to go right on into the millennium. That's what Jesus meant in Matthew 24, where he says, he that endures to the end shall be saved or spared. Those in the tribulation who endure to the end of the tribulation will be spared, and they'll get to go into that millennial reign of Jesus Christ. And again, it will be great. And so that's the two time periods coming up, and that's what we do. Next of all, take a look with me here in Matthew chapter 13. I want to take a look at two parables, the mustard seed and the leaven. And the mustard seed and the leaven are brought out in verse 13, verse 31 and 32. And then they're going to be brought out in chapter 13 and verse 33. This talks about the church age. It's going to talk about two types of attacks that Satan will come into the church over. The church is going to be compared to two things. It's going to be compared to a lump of bread that's waiting to be baked. And on the other side, it's going to be referred to as a tree that grows up very rapidly. It's going to talk about two different things, internal attacks and external attacks on the church as the church grows during the 2,000 years it will be here. And so turn with me to Matthew chapter 13. While you're turning there, let me just talk to you quickly about those, again, who are my armor bearers, those of you who work with me, those of you who stand with me, those of you who love me, I love you too. But we both love the Lord, and we both love the Lord, and we have a common goal inside of us. Some people are just given to orphans. Some are just given to winning the lost in Africa. Some nations are laid on people's hearts, and you join in with people who have that same burden with you because that's what's on you. But others, like me, have a real burden to see Christians become disciples, raised up, and those disciples to become ministers. I have it in my heart from the time that I stepped down pastoring to help raise up a new generation of ministers as well as making disciples out of converts. And I'm not doing this through a local church. I'm doing this through a traveling ministry. And my main ministry, again, is to schools, Bible schools, and then after that, to ministers' conferences, and then I also go to churches. But again, thank you for those who have that same burden in your heart. You know, you see people get saved, you go, wow, that's great, but they don't seem to have an impact in the world. They have no stability. It's because they never go on to become disciples in the Lord Jesus, of which Jesus said in John 8 to those who just believed in him, if you continue in my word, then are you my disciples indeed, and you'll know the truth, and the truth will make you free. It's not the word that makes you free. It's knowing the word that makes you free. It's not just having the truth. It's knowing the truth. Just a Bible on your desk will not make you spiritual. It's taking that word off those pages and putting it into your heart, and that's where you begin to grow in the things of God. That's my ministry. So if you'd like to join me, you feel just compelled, that's exactly what I feel, then why don't you look to my website, BobYandian.com, and I would love for you to become a partner with me. Look forward to it. Rejoice in the fact that we're going to be joining hands, joining hearts, and help to get that message out. So again, BobYandian.com. There's a place on there where you can become a partner with me. Matthew 13, look, take a look with me at verses 31 and 32. Another parable he put forth to them, saying, the kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds, but when it grows up, is the greatest among herbs and becomes a tree, so that the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches of it. The church is compared here to a grain of mustard seed that started out so small on the day of Pentecost and with 120 in the upper room. And today it numbers into the millions upon millions of Christians around the world. It grew up to be a great tree, and it grew up in no time. And you know, this mustard tree, despite all the opposition, just kept on growing. But it says that when it's begun to grow, then birds begin to land in the branches of it. In Mark chapter 4, we are told in the beginning of this parable also that the birds come and that they take of the seed and they take and pull the seed out of the ground. In this case, they can't pull the seed out of the ground, but they land in the branches of it. And this speaks about external attacks against the church, about things throughout the Word of God that the church was under attack, and it was attacked from religion on the outside and government control on the outside. Again, this is compared in this verse of Scripture to the birds that are landing here. And again, the demons are religion, government, world opinion, trying to slow down or stop the growth of the church or completely destroy the church altogether. We know that's not going to happen. We go through times of opposition. We know there's times when governments stand against us. We know there's times when religious attacks come against us. We know there's times when the world through the press comes against us and starts to attack us, because all of these are part of the world system. We stand alone as far as the church is concerned, and this is how God displays himself in the earth, is through the church. It's up to us to stand for the things of God, stand on the word of God, and realize one thing also. Jesus said, I will build my church and the gates of hell, all the demons, all the birds of the air, cannot destroy it. And it's got a future to it. And the future is we're going to gain greater and greater control as more and more of the gospel is preached throughout the world. I have a series called The Kingdom Parables. You can have a copy for yourself. The announcer's about to come on and tell you how you can have one.
Chapter 13 of Matthew is a pivotal chapter in the Gospel of Matthew. In this revealing chapter, Jesus turns his attention away from Israel and toward the Gentiles. He begins to teach in parables about the kingdom of God so that those who truly desire to hear would understand his message. In these 7 in-depth topical studies, Pastor Bob Yandian explores and teaches on the parables found in the book of Matthew. Sermon titles include The Mystery Presented, The Sower and the Seed, Why Parables, The Wheat and the Tares, The Mustard Seed and Leaven, The Treasure and the Pearl, and The Evangelism Net. To order Kingdom Parables, visit our website at BobYandian.com. Bob Yandian Ministries is training up a new generation in the Word of God. Because of your generosity and faithfulness,
This teaching ministry is able to change countless lives. You will never know until you get to heaven how many people received Jesus, were filled with the Holy Spirit, healed, or found God's will for their life through your support and prayers. Pastors, if you would like to schedule Bob Yandian to speak at your church, event, or conference, go to bobyandian.com/invite.
I want to read that verse of scripture again that we ended with just before the break. And here Jesus said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed," Matthew 13:31, "which a man took and sowed into his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds. But when it grows up, is the greatest among herbs, becomes a tree so that the birds of the air come and lodge in it." Again, the church here is compared to a mustard seed, that it grows into a large tree and the birds come and lodge in the branch. The church, which was so obscure, it started with just a few on the day of Pentecost. Throughout history, the world thought they could destroy it. Kingdoms thought they could destroy it. Religion thought they could destroy it. But Jesus said before it ever started, he said, "I'll build my church and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." We find through the book of Acts how the religion tried their best to destroy it. And every time they tried to destroy it, they scattered the people. The people would just start somewhere else. They were like, also, every believer was like a mustard seed. It just kept spreading and spreading. And this thing has covered the earth. The demons still come. And this refers to outside influences on the church. The world system out here, Satan's system out here. The next one we'll get into, which is 11, is internal problems within the church, how Satan attacks from both the external and the internal. I was talking to a group of pastors one day. I said, honestly, there's only two types of trouble your church can face. So they quickly wrote down, what's this going to be? And I said, external or internal? It's like, well, wait a minute. It's usually switching back and forth from one to the other. That's the truth. And sometimes you have both attacks at the same time. And there's time you figure, I mean, I've seen ministers get so finally despondent and say, man, it's like the trouble never ends. I said, that's true, but the answers never end. The joy and victory never end. Instead of looking at this thing as battle, battle, battle with victories in between, why don't you look at victory, victory, victory with battles in between? Every battle is headed toward a victory. Every storm has to stop eventually, and the sun on the other side, which was there all the time, will come out. This is what we're talking about. So again, with 120 in the upper room, this thing has spread to worldwide, and Jesus said this would happen, but the birds come and land in the trees. The demons, the birds in this verse of scripture, land in the branches of it, and this is religion, governments, and the world's opinion, the world system, which is the press and all the different means of entertainment, news, and all that the world has constantly has a slant in it against the things of God, against morality, against churches, against the preaching of morality. And they even try to legislate that, which in chapter 4 of Acts, when they tried to legislate the fact they couldn't preach in the name of Jesus anymore, they said, listen, and they were completely submissive when they did this. They said, sirs, whether to obey you or to obey God, we have no choice. We're going to obey God. In other words, if what you were asking us to do lined up with what God asked us to do, we would do it. But when you ask us to oppose what God has said, we have to go with God. And they went back, reported what was said. They all rejoiced. An earthquake shook the church for God's stamp of approval, and they went out and preached in the name of Jesus. Listen to what Psalm, the second Psalm says in verses 1-5. It says, why do the heathen rage? And the people imagine a vain thing. The kings of this earth set themselves and the rulers take counsel against the Lord and against his anointed. That's the church. And they say, let us break their bands asunder. Let's, these chains they've got on, these bands on us, that they keep slowing us down and cast away their cords. That's their ropes from us. He who sits in the heavens will laugh. The Lord will have them in derision. Then he will speak to them in his wrath and terrify them in his displeasure. This verse is saying, you know, this is what's happening. You go to some of the meetings in the White House, some of the meetings in Congress, some of the meetings places, and this is what they're discussing. This church, we can't stand this church. Every time we turn around, they're coming, they're preaching this truth stuff, and we don't want that. We want to stop that. And so they said, let's break their bands. You're not going to do it. Let's stop them from slowing us down. You're not going to do it. I like to look at it this way. You and I are not going to stop the world. We're not even going to change the world. The church is not here to stop the world. The church is here to preach the gospel, lay hands on the sick, see them recover, make disciples of all nations. But on the other hand, we are to get involved in political things. But understand this, you are not going to stop Satan's system. Jesus will. When he comes back, Jesus is not going to preach the gospel, and we are not going to stop the world. But in the meantime, what do we do to the world while we're here? We are the mud they have to swim through to get anything done. We slow them down, and the world just gets tired of the things they want to accomplish. Satan thought he would have this accomplished centuries ago, but it's still going on, and it's slow progress and slow progress. He's been working in all different areas of the world for the past 2,000 years. He's closer than ever, but the point he can't realize is he can even read the Bible and find it out. It's all going to come to naught because Jesus is going to come back and literally stop everything. He's going to destroy the world system. The world system can't be stopped and the world system can't be changed. There's only one thing you can do with the world system, destroy it. And Jesus will come back and destroy it. In the meantime, he's given us power over the world. He said, I've overcome the world, be of good cheer, but he has not come back and completely changed it. He's going to do that when he comes back again. We talked about it at the beginning of this broadcast. He's going to remove all unbelievers from the earth, all religion from the earth. He's going to remove all unbelievers from the earth. He's going to remove Antichrist, Satan, demons, fallen angels. He's going to remove all of these things. And the earth will, at that time, for 1,000 years, will start out with just believers only under the rule of the Lord Jesus Christ for 1,000 years. That's what that is going to come. And in this verse, it says God will have them and he'll laugh at them. He'll sit in the heavens and laugh. And it says he has them in derision. You know what it means to deride somebody? It means to make fun of them. God the Father turns to Jesus and said, did you hear what they say? They're going to overthrow us. And I imagine all the angels start laughing. Jesus laughs. God the Father gets a good laugh out of that. Then they say, let's stop them. Let's break their cords. Did you hear that? My church, of which I said the gates of hell wouldn't prevail against, they think they can stop the church. If they can't stop the church, or if I can't stop the church, it's going to make me successful. Satan can't stop the church. The gates of hell, all the governments of hell can't stop us. Who do these guys think they are? And then it says he's going to laugh at them and then come back at them in his sore displeasure. And that will be when Jesus Christ comes back to rule the earth. That is external attacks against the church. Let's switch over to internal attacks against the church. Verse 33. Here it says, he spoke another parable to them. The kingdom of heaven is like leaven, which a woman put and took and hid in 3 measures of meal until the whole lump was leavened. In this case, we have the church compared to a lump of dough. And the woman puts leaven into it. Now, leaven is usually a type of sin in the Word of God, but understand this, there's a little bit of truth to leaven. Women, you need a little bit of leaven in that bread, and you need a little bit of leaven in other things, maybe in whatever you do. And Jesus ate leavened bread, but at the time of the Passover, at the time of the meal, he ate with the disciples the Last Supper. In that case, there was no leaven in it, because leaven is usually a type of sin. But here's the point. A little bit of leaven is okay. A little leaven leavens the whole lump. So you be careful. You put just a little in it. Too much causes it to puff up. Here's what happens with leaven. Leaven takes that which is hard, compacted, and raises it up to where it becomes a loaf of bread. In other words, it adds air to it. And so the air comes up and that piece, listen, the bread doesn't weigh any more than it did before. It doesn't add any weight to it. It just puffs it up and makes it look bigger and gives it a better consistency. But a little bit's all you need, because too much will destroy it. And what the Lord is simply saying here is a little bit of leaven's okay, but it's like a woman putting leaven into bread. Leaven represents internal attacks against the church. There literally are, in the Word of God, 3 different types of leaven found in the New Testament. Again, this woman will reach her peak in the time of the tribulation as the one riding on the beast, international religion. That will be Revelation chapter 17, verses 1 through 15. And so leaven, again, is a type of evil or sin in the Word of God. Let me give some scriptures on that. Exodus chapter 12, verses 8 and 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 5, verses 6 and 7. And Galatians 3:9 tells us about this. But leaven puffs up and makes the lump appear bigger than it is. Let me tell you what this is. Leaven, again, has 3 types found in the New Testament. There's the leaven of the Pharisees. Luke chapter 12 and verse 1 says this, in the meantime, there were gathered together a great multitude of people, insomuch that they were stepping on each other. And he began to say to his disciples, first of all, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees, which is hypocrisy. And so the leaven of the Pharisees is law. And they added law again to the teaching of the Word of God. And they try to get people to go back under the law. The point of it is the tiny bit of the law is okay. Now, let me please say that to where you understand that. Law doesn't necessarily mean the law of Moses. The law can also mean not sinning. And we never want to preach grace to where literally sin is okay. No, we need to come back and teach righteousness and teach sanctification. But if that's all you teach in your church, you become legalistic. Again, a little bit is necessary. The emphasis on grace ought to be this big, and the emphasis on obeying God and not sinning ought to be over here also, but a smaller amount. If you keep coming back, and you see your congregation, you know that some of them in sin, and all you preach about is sin, 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 what you're doing is you're overloading that lump with the leaven. And so this is what Jesus warned about. Let's go to the second type of leaven. This leaven is Sadducees. Now, the Pharisees, again, was legalism. And so, again, teaching on righteous living can turn into legalism if that's all you do, to where people depend on their own energy of the flesh to accomplish this. The second one's the leaven of the Sadducees, which is denial of the supernatural. And we need to have guidelines on the supernatural, but we don't deny the supernatural. Some churches, that's all they do, is the supernatural. You come to church, that's all it is tongues, interpretation of tongues, prophecies, and there's a word of knowledge and healings going on through the whole service. Thank God for those types of services once in a while, but this is telling us you cannot overload it. Matthew 16:11, how is it you do not understand that I speak to you not of bread, but you should beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the Sadducees. And so he tells us to beware of that. The next one is, the third one is the Herodians, Mark 8:15. This is politics entering into the church. He charged them, saying, take heed, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and of the leaven of Herod. These are the Herodians. They saw the answer for everything is a change of government, change of government. I like to see change of government. I like to see conservatives in office. I like to see those that believe in the Lord, but I have to understand something. They are not going to change the world. Do we get involved politically? Yes, but watch it. You don't want every church service to turn into a political fiasco, because why? We are not going to straighten the world out. Jesus is going to do that. We've got to get back to the number one priority, winning souls and making disciples out of all nations. So again, a small amount of leaven is needed for the bread because it's dense. Here's what happens is that we sometimes as ministers stick our stories into our sermons. That's okay. A little bit, that's okay. But if the whole sermon turns into something about you, you become the standard. Let everything, even the stories you do, point back to the fact that Jesus is in control. This is the importance of it. Too much of it is leaven. This is, again, internal attacks against the church, which can eventually, again, destroy that church. All these things are brought out again in my teaching series here on these teaching on the kingdom parables. You'll enjoy it. The announcer is going to come on and tell you how you can have a copy for yourself. We'll be back tomorrow and we'll continue on with this subject as we go on again with the kingdom parables. I will see you tomorrow.
Chapter 13 of Matthew is a pivotal chapter in the Gospel of Matthew. In this revealing chapter, Jesus turns his attention away from Israel and toward the Gentiles. He begins to teach in parables about the kingdom of God so that those who truly desire to hear would understand his message. In these 7 in-depth topical studies, Pastor Bob Yandian explores and teaches on the parables found in the book of Matthew. Sermon titles include The Mystery Presented, The Sower and the Seed, Why Parables, The Wheat and the Tares, The Mustard Seed and Leaven, The Treasure and the Pearl, and The Evangelism Net. To order Kingdom Parables, visit our website at bobyandian.com. You can order resources, become a partner, or browse free articles and podcasts by visiting our website at bobyandian.com. You can also join our mailing list and receive weekly devotions and the latest ministry updates. Thank you for watching today's broadcast. We'll see you next time on Student of the Word with Bob Yandian.